on Catalyst, a special report on the impact of our digital age. Is social media creating a narcissism epidemic? Are digital natives better at doing multiple tasks? And can our behaviour be changed by avatars?
On October 29th, 1969, the world's first internet message was sent between two computers in California. It consisted of the letter L followed by O. Then the system crashed. Just over 40 years later, there are more than 2 billion people connected to the internet. The scale, the breadth of the activity is mind-blowing.
We're all plugged into the big fat information pipe now. We can contact a massive library. Information is on tap.
They're a side issue of salad, you know, and they're in the restaurants. Everyone has their mobiles. You only have to see people incessantly using their thumbs while they're talking to someone else. You only have to see people with those white wires in their heads, not communicating or connecting with the outside world, let alone each other.
The virtual revolution is transforming the way we shop, manage our health, entertain ourselves, and even how we make friends.
Websites like Facebook and Twitter and YouTube really allow people to seek attention for themselves.
I can do things we can never do in the physical world. The rules, the physics of how social interactions work get completely changed.
I think the question of the impact of technology on young brains is as broad a question as that, let's say, of climate change. It's unprecedented, it's highly controversial, some people think we're doomed.
Whatever you think of digital technology, one thing's certain, there's no going back.
Digital technology is now so pervasive that there's an app that shows me what's in front of my phone so I don't run into things. If I lose connection, I feel anxious and thirsty for information. So if I'm feeling so ill at ease without it, what's all this constant stimulation actually doing to my brain?
If you practice juggling for a week, then your brain is going to change. Now imagine for the past 10 years, you have been sitting at your computer a few hours a day and using internet. Of course it has changed you. There is no way that it shouldn't.
What level are you on?
Mac 4.
We're on
Mac 5.
I'm on Mac 10.
Oh, do the pink. I wonder what's the pink. What are those colours?
It's icing.
Ah.
At first, it seems like good news. There's evidence our visual IQ is going up. Our on-screen environments are becoming so sophisticated, they're improving our spatial visualisation and orientation skills. To keep track of what's happening, viewers are becoming experts at dividing their attention. But that's key to the problem. A growing body of evidence is suggesting information overload is turning us into scattered thinkers.
Rather like fast food is not good for us, so too fast information is not good for us either, because we don't digest, we don't spend any time on it, we just consume it.
Professor David Nicholas, Director of Cyber Research and a former lecturer of the University College of London, has been studying the way we process information on the internet.
Whatever it is you do in a digital form, you leave a trace. We call it a digital footprint. So we have this marvellous, huge database of millions and millions of people. So for the very first time ever, we actually know how people behave in terms of information seeking. This was the huge shock. Nobody seems to dwell for any period of time anywhere. But what people seem to be doing is just skipping the surface, skittering. They spend seconds, minutes on something, and then they're off to something else.
Digital natives, users born after 1993, are less focused or engaged with each site. But is that a concern?
Your brain is not there to give you education. Your brain is part of a biological organism that tries to maximize things such as, for example, how easily you can get on with life without having to spend much energy, much time, or much effort. And if this maximizes your gain without putting much effort in it. Your brain is, of course, going to do this. This is very, very rational. If you take your child away from internet and just tell them, you have to go to the encyclopedia in paper and find the answer, write it down in your notebook and take it to your teacher. Yes, she will be able to focus greatly, but 20 years from now, that is not what's going to get her in front of everybody else. Because everybody else does that in a second.
When set to a specific research task, older and younger users displayed startling differences in the way they gather information. Older Gen X users took an average of 3.5 minutes to find the answer on the internet, while digital natives took about 30 seconds. One would assume that's because the younger generation are better at using the technology. But that's not the whole story.
They just want to find things quickly, go past the finishing post and say, hey you guys, I found it. But what they found isn't very good. Their behaviour lacks evaluation. They choose the first ones up on Google because that is fast.
Whereas the older people were spending much more time, they were comparing sites, and in fact, their answers were more correct than the young person's.
The Google generation grabbed the words that we'd given them, cut and pasted it, and stuck it into the search engine, and then they got the answer. But universities are still behaving in many ways in a Victorian way.
We put them in an exam hall for 3 hours. They're not allowed to use computer. They have to use their hands to write. None of them have ever written that long. What we get is illegible, is not very well researched. We give low marks, and the whole system is dysfunctional. It doesn't work. We live in a parallel universe.
If you think of skimming research books in the same way, it's easy to see how flitting from one page to the next goes against deeper learning.
You know, if A equals B and B equals C, then A equals C. You know, always you have a sequence. It's not random. And I think that if you're, again, engaged in activities where you are doing things in parallel, where you're hypertexting, where you're not following a linear cause and effect sequence, that might have a very profound effect on your actual thinking powers.
The idea that multitasking information leads to a decline in our thinking powers is backed by other studies. People who are constantly interrupted by emails and calls have been shown to be less creative and productive than those who do one thing at a time. Text, cluttered with links, is less easily absorbed than printed material.
Digital banners prevent viewers from absorbing as much of a news broadcast as they would with an uninterrupted screen. And students who browse the internet during class remember less of the lecture than those that keep their laptop closed.
We're constantly being bombarded by stimuli, by emails, by Twitters, and all we go into is responsive mode.
With all this unprecedented access to information from television, the internet, and telecommunications, many of us no longer give ourselves the gift of switching off. It's in these moments where we can reflect and process what we've learnt into a deeper, more mindful knowledge. Without those moments, we may simply become more shallow.
That photo is so ugly. Need a new one for sure. Bit of lippy, not too much makeup, don't want to look too slutty. Ready for the photos.
If there's a place to be shallow, this is it. Facebook is now the number one search term on the internet. Even away from the screens, many of us are obsessing about our online social life, editing our real-life experiences into something that resembles a brochure of the good life.
It's as though identity now is externally created, not generated from within. It's derived from how many hits you've got, it's how quickly you can report on what you're doing, how many people are impressed by what you're doing.
Ew. Oh my God, Em, you are a stunner.
That's the worst shot, you look so fat.
It's not just Facebook. There's Twitter, Vimeo, blogs, MySpace, YouTube, a plethora of sites all geared towards broadcasting yourself, right down to the most intimate detail.
So today we are going to talk about my Louis Vuitton bag.
I'm wearing this bright pink lipstick. I don't know if it does look nice on me or not.
A lot of people might not think that I deserve as much as I have.
It's the morning and I'm just gonna have breakfast, so I decided to actually do a video of my favorite breakfast.
According to research by Professor Jean Twenge, all this self-focus is fueling a disturbing trend in human behavior.
We have rising plastic surgery rates. We have this obsession with fame and celebrity. We have more materialistic values than we used to.
American youth are in the grip of what Twenge describes as a narcissism epidemic.
We did several within campus studies to try to find out what the generational change was in narcissism. All told, about 50,000 college students who filled out the narcissistic personality inventory at some point between 1982 and 2009.
The narcissism personality inventory is a commonly used measure of narcissistic traits in individuals.
And we found that the number who scored very high on narcissism, that percentage used to be only about 17%, and in the most recent samples, it was about 30%. Just the average change is just as large as the increase in obesity that people call the obesity epidemic.
Narcissism is a bit like blood pressure. If you've got too much, it's a problem. If you have too little, it's a problem. And the most excessive form, someone who would have a narcissistic personality disorder would be somebody who has little or no empathy for people around them, is quite conceited, arrogant, haughty, feels that their needs are more important than others. They're quite grandiose, tend to fantasize about things like that, and nothing's ever quite good enough. Although what a lot of people would refer to, I suppose, in a lay sense of narcissism is probably better described as vanity.
Even if it's just at the personality trait level and not at that clinical level disorder, there's a number of problems with it. So first, narcissism is just toxic to relationships with others. People who score high on narcissism often get nominated to be the leader, but they can't take the other person's perspective, and it's all about them, they're selfish, they're not good team players in the long run. They have this overconfidence. It's not just confidence, it's overconfidence.
In other words, narcissists love success, but their personality sets them up for failure.
It's been shown that people with more friends on Facebook score higher on narcissistic traits than those with less friends. But can you really blame social networking for the rise in narcissism?
The increase in narcissism seemed to be accelerating after about 2005 or 2006, which is exactly when a lot of this internet technology and social networking websites and so on really got going.
It does cultivate narcissism, this notion that everyone is interested in what you're doing, however banal, every minute of the day. Reminds me of a little child, you know, look at me, mummy, I'm putting on one sock. Look at me, I'm putting on the other sock. Because if you don't look at me, how do I know I exist?
Well, I think it can bring out some ill-savoury traits that we all possess to some degree. Whether or not you can say that tweeting what you had for lunch will cause you to become a malignant narcissist is a bit of a stretch.
Jean Twenge attributes the narcissism epidemic to four combined causes: the internet, easy credit, celebrity-soaked media, and permissive parenting.
There's been a shift away from the child seeking the parent's approval to the parent seeking the child's approval. And that really puts the kid at the center of things. We treat our kids as royalty and we ask them what they want all the time and so on. But if you're hanging on to that idea of the whole world revolves around me for longer, that's not a great strategy for succeeding in your 20s and into your 30s.
Well, I think it's important to distinguish between self-esteem and self-respect. Self-respect is to value yourself, to make the most of the gifts that you have in life. And I think that's a fairly solitary experience. Whereas self-esteem is very much living one's life through other people's eyes, what some sociologists would call other regarding. If we become addicted to the esteem of others for our own well-being, then yes, that is essentially the essence of narcissism.
Professor Joanna Wynn has been leading a long-term Australian study of Gen X and Gen Y. Although not directly measuring narcissistic traits, the Life Patterns Project has revealed a contrasting picture of Australian youth.
Do you have any sense where you might be with your life in 10 years' time?
I'd like to be an expert in climate change and energy efficiency, which is something I've taken a great interest to.
We don't see evidence that they're greedy or self-centred or selfish. Quite to the contrary, we see them as being quite ethical. They are also realistic in the sense that no one much else is looking out for them. And so it does come down to you. I don't see that as narcissistic. Actually, I see it as a need to be very aware, to be acutely aware of what you're doing and how you're doing it and who you are.
I enjoy doing this. And I've been told by a lot of, mentors, do something you love. I really love problem solving and finding solutions to, people's problems. I've got a drive for success and very extremely outcome focused.
And I'd say they're not more individualistic because we're seeing rates of volunteering go up. We've seen the most educated generation ever. They know that they need to have multiple options open all the time. One of the effects of the technology is that it speeds things up. It enables them to live a faster pace.
I'm not really motivated by fame. It's more, for me, I guess it's happiness. I mean, everybody wants happiness.
I guess the digital communication amplifies both good and bad. It amplifies opportunities for abusive relationships and abusive information, and it also amplifies opportunities to connect in positive ways.
Posting about exactly what you're doing and those material type values that you may have, you grow out of that sort of sense and it just becomes a form of just keeping in touch.
It is quite narcissistic in a way. I think it's something that unfortunately nowadays we can't live without. I think if you disconnect from social networking, you really disconnect from millions of people.
Whether or not social networking can create narcissists, there's no doubt it's an arena that can provide the attention they crave. But narcissistic tendencies and rapid-fire communication is a volatile mix.
People are anonymous and they have the chance just to be very cruel to each other, and they tend to take that chance. And that's also a typical behavior for someone who's narcissistic, to just lash out at people that they don't like and insult them.
There was a study by Michigan State University of 1,400 students showing over the last 30 years a decline in empathy, particularly marked in the last 10. Now this coincides, of course, with the rise of the so-called digital native.
It's an unregulated environment. It's the Wild West. And what is concerning to me is that people invest real emotion, in a sense almost hyper-real emotion. It's quite hard to be nasty or horrible to someone when they're there. It's much easier to kind of push a button than it is to actually say it face to face.
An important consequence of being nasty to other people is that you lose your reputation. And internet and social media are much stronger and much more dynamic environments for developing and losing reputation.
We've all seen the consequences of a compromising post in cyberspace. They can be bigger, faster, and longer lasting than an offline mistake. The web never forgets. But sometimes, just occasionally, it forgives. Whichever way you look at it, there's nothing inherently good or evil about digital technology. Like medication or the cars we drive, it's the way we choose to use it that will either benefit or harm us. But if you're thinking we've got about as absorbed as we can get with our life online, think again. Graham Phillips steps into cyberspace, boots and all.
Researchers here at Stanford University believe we'll soon be interacting with each other on the computer via avatars. These are digital representations of you and me in the virtual world. Already, there are computer games where players interact via avatars.
Hey guys, welcome back.
Hey everybody.
You can sit at home and meet your friends in virtual reality to chat, even gesture to each other.
Face recognition, body tracking, now even facial expressions.
Microsoft
has released a product called Avatar Connect, where you socialize with other avatars, but those avatars are mimicking your gestures and they're capturing your facial expressions.
Your smile, your laugh, and even the raise of your eyebrows.
What it does is it takes this social networking that we love so much with devices like Facebook and puts an avatar layer on it, an avatar that moves like you do.
All coming to your living room.
And in the future, it won't be just living room games. More and more of our interactions could be through avatars.
For about an hour a day, kids are spending time inside of an avatar in the United States. To put that in perspective, they read print for about 38 minutes a day. So the avatar is becoming the medium of the future.
That means the environment of the future will be virtual reality. What are the psychological consequences of spending more time in worlds like these than in actual reality? That's what this lab is dedicated to answering. Remarkably, they've found our brains are easily fooled when it comes to reality.
So, Graham, we're going to have you walk the virtual pit. In order for you to do that, we're going to need to track your ankles. So I'm going to have these two ankle sensors that I'm going to have you attach. Is that okay with you?
Sure.
Okay. Yeah. Your ankle.
The infrared sensors are tracked by 8 cameras around the ceiling. So my feet are precisely followed for the virtual world.
So I've got to walk the plank.
So we're going to have you walk the virtual plank.
Yes. All right. I should try that in real life. It looks pretty easy in real life.
Yeah, there's no actual pit in this room, so try to remind yourself.
Oh, yeah, this is very easy to do.
But then the weird part happened. The virtual reality goggles took me into a reality that wasn't that different.
In fact, it appears to be a room that's pretty much exactly the same as this room.
Yes, so this is an exact rendering of this room that we have built from the AutoCAD blueprints.
And that was a key to the illusion I was about to experience, because my brain had already accepted the actual room as real.
All right, next we're going to open the floor.
It looks like the real room.
And now we've changed something. So we've actually opened up the floor of the room to see a virtual pit.
Yeah, you've got a dungeon here, I see.
Correct. How do you feel?
Whoa. Look, it's quite realistic, actually. It does feel a little imposing. I've got to walk across this blank. I don't know, what is that, a 20-meter drop either side?
Correct, yeah. And now I'm going to ask you to take a step off into the pit to see what happens. All right.
Whoa.
I got you.
I actually feel like this is a slightly scary thing to do. So take a step into the pit.
Yeah, just remind yourself there's a physical room, right? So there's no actual pit there.
Oh, I'm down here now. Where are you? All up there?
Your heart starts beating. You know intellectually that this is just the virtual world, that you're in a room, that you can't get hurt, but your body does not know that. Your brain is sending it all these signals. Do not cross the chasm on a plank, be careful.
I was beamed into a classroom of students with very natural body movements, but who just stared at me.
Hello. Oh, so when they track around with me. It's like some surreal sci-fi movie.
That continual eye contact may be freaky, but it's the key, along with the virtual mirror back there.
I didn't even see you up the back. Hello.
To giving this world an extra level of reality.
It is a powerful psychological experience, and we say it's rooted in your back brain, meaning it's a response that even when you know up front in your high-level cognition areas, you know it's not real, your back brain wins this debate.
But back to our question. How do these virtual worlds affect me?
One finding that is very inherent throughout our over decade of research on this is that things that happen in the virtual world are not free. So when you have a virtual experience, it can profoundly affect you outside of virtual reality, sometimes for good, sometimes for bad.
The bad effects of video games are well studied. So Jeremy's lab decided to look at the possible good effects. Can human behavior be changed for the better using avatars?
So if I build an avatar that looks just like you and then show you your avatar getting healthy and your avatar losing weight as a function of exercise, when you leave the virtual world, that profound experience changes the way that you think about your own health and you'll actually behave more healthier.
Rather than healthier, today I'm going to be taught to conserve energy by taking quicker showers. I watch my poor avatar eat coal, consuming an amount equivalent to the electricity used to heat my shower.
Yeah, that other Graham's not enjoying the task, I don't think.
When people use this virtual shower, afterwards in the real world, they do tend to take shorter showers. In another study, people were given a superpower, the ability to fly and save a sick child.
This sounds like a job for Superman.
After their heroic efforts in the virtual world, the volunteers were exposed to a faked-up calamity in the real world.
When they leave virtual reality, there's a crisis. A woman out in the other room has a crisis, and we measure how thoroughly and how quickly they help that woman.
Remarkably, spend even a short time in this world, and you'll give that woman better assistance.
Having a virtual experience where you fly like Superman and help save a child's life, that makes you more helpful in the real world.
But one of the downsides of virtual reality is it can be a bit too real. Take this beautiful place.
Just take a moment to look around. You can check out the fish. There's a shark there.
I was going
to
say, I saw a shark up there.
You can see the shark as he circles around you.
Assume he won't give me a little nip.
Yeah, he's been programmed to be pretty nice. Don't even worry.
Oh, hey, the shark's just giving me a whack.
Now, I'm swimming with a shark, but in a previous study, kids swam with virtual whales, and the results were disturbing.
A week later, we bring back those same children and we ask them, hey, have you ever been to SeaWorld, which is an amusement park in the United States, and swam around with whales? 50% of our children formed false memories, meaning they thought the virtual experience was something that had actually happened to them in physical life.
We have something called source amnesia. We may remember the content of something, but we don't remember how we found out.
But one of the biggest dangers of virtual reality is it will be so alluring.
You want one to unplug. And so virtual life and internet life is so much more preferable to real life, because in real life you have to negotiate with real people who may not say what you want, and the rules aren't always so clear, and it's a little unstructured.
With virtual reality starting to hit living rooms now, we'll find out sooner rather than later where this technology will lead us. Next time on Catalyst, bioprinting replacement organs for humans, a bold plan to clean up space junk, and a party drug for treating depression.